Patrick Fandaro here, co-founder at Vetted Biz. You're about to hear my interview with Tariq Johnson. He's a YouTuber with over 400,000 views on his videos related to franchising. He was a multi-unit franchisee, having started a location from scratch of a juice franchise, also buying an existing franchise on the other side of the country. Tariq Johnson has a strong background in wealth management, and he's parlayed those skills from franchising and wealth management. So combining wealth management and his experience operating two franchise locations, one of them really semi-absentee, he's able to parlay that experience and help prospective franchisees, as well as help ongoing operations of franchises as a franchise coach. So learn about his journey before you embark on your own journey. In the video, we're gonna go through his profitable franchise formula, four-step process, a step-by-step when you're moving forward with a franchise opportunity, what you should be doing as you study different franchise opportunities. Tariq is also gonna go through the number one most important factor to determine your success in a franchise. So stay tuned and join me for my interview with Tariq Johnson. Hey, you have Patrick Fandaro here, co-founder at Vetted Biz. Very excited to have on Tariq Johnson, who not only has the biggest franchise YouTube channel, but he actually owned a few franchises and successfully had an exit. And now he's one of the fastest growing franchise coaches in the United States. So Tariq, I really appreciate you joining me today.
Yeah, absolutely, Patrick. Happy to have another conversation. Excited to be here.
Yeah. So yeah, thanks for having me on your show last week. We talked about a lot of different themes, but a few that I'd like to dive into. But for those listening to the podcast or watching on YouTube, maybe it'd be good just to talk a little bit about your background and how you got into franchising in the first place.
Yeah, sure. So I'll start with the franchising part first and then kind of work backwards from there a little bit. But the most recently, about 7 years ago, my wife and I had signed a franchise agreement to open a franchise in a brand new shopping center, which is probably one of the hardest ways to do it. A shopping center that still hadn't even been constructed yet. And so we got that. We wind up opening up that franchise. Took, I think, 2 years from when we signed our lease, got it profitable in less than 2 months, and then went on to then buy another franchise with that brand all the way across the country in Florida, resale, and eventually wound up selling both locations at different times. One about 6 months ago, the other one late in 2020. I wound up starting a YouTube channel just because I just wanted to share my experiences and mistakes that I made. I felt like I made a ton of mistakes. And, you know, so people that, you know, some people reach out trying to think that I'm a guru or expert, and that's not it. And that's really not how I position myself. I'm learning every day myself, and I made a ton of mistakes, and I just try to help people avoid mistakes that I made in the process. So that's on the franchising side of things. And from a, you know, career perspective, I started getting my investment licenses when I was 19 years old, Series 6, 63, Series 7, all that stuff, dropped out of college, kind of rose up the ranks in the financial services world, always wanted to be an entrepreneur. It was always my dream. And I just felt stuck for so long, and just analysis paralysis and being a very analytical person and overthinker. I just really couldn't kind of crack the code by myself doing my own thing. And, you know, franchising was my first success, like very successful enterprise where I finally broke what I felt like was the pattern of being able to like make a business work. And so I think for some people, franchising can be a great option. So that's a little bit about me.
And working in the financial advisory space, like how did you leverage that knowledge, like advising clients on public equity investments and all different types of investments, to like selecting the right franchise for you and your wife?
Yeah, I'm very honest about the fact that I had a very poor decision-making process on choosing the right franchise. So the truth is that given what I know now, I probably would have made a different decision in terms of the franchise that I had selected. And that's not to say that it didn't work out, you know, that I regret my decision, because I don't. And I think everything happens for a reason. But, you know, that's part of the mistake I made. I didn't know what I knew now. I had some confirmation bias in the process, but you know, what helped was that, you know, the, the financial advising space requires you to understand overall macroeconomics and what's going on with the economy. And I had personal finance experience. I started out as a teller, worked as a personal banker, did business banking with clients. So, you know, I had a wide array of just personal finance experience that just overall helped me with the process. But I had to fumble through and learn a tremendous amount by myself.
And how did you go about the process? Did you have like a franchise coach or consultant helping you in terms of like selecting different franchises? Or was it just you were a customer of the brand, you decided to see if they franchised?
No, man, I did it. I did it all on my own. And this is the kind of the impetus of the overall mindset I had was I wanted to position myself to get free from my job. At the time I started making multiple six figures, and I just thought, this is great, but this is terrible because how am I ever going to leave? Like, how am I ever going
to... Was it just you wanted to control your time, or what was the big motivation? What didn't you like in that job?
Yeah, the actual work of advising clients, I loved, man, just sitting down and putting together retirement plans and helping understand people's goals and make recommendations. I loved that part of it. But yeah, the one, I felt like as an advisor, as a financial advisor, you're kind of almost like a glorified salesperson in a sense. And I just felt like I would see the way that the banks or the credit unions that I was working for could shift like higher level decisions the way they were running their business. And I didn't have any ability to really contribute in a meaningful way in those conversations. It was kind of like, hey man, stay in your lane.
Sell our product.
Yeah.
Maybe make a nice margin on this structured product. Just sell it, dude.
Yep. And nowadays I have a few clients that are like successful in the tech sales space and they make a lot of money. And it's a similar situation where they're making a lot of money, but they're not fulfilled because they don't feel like they're tapping into their true potential. And that's how I felt. I felt like I can contribute in a bigger way in strategic decisions. And so I felt like one, that wasn't there. The idea of sitting in an office and kind of showing up to a 9-to-5 for the next 15 or 20 years terrified me. and then because of my investment licenses, the regulations were super strict. So
you can't even have a blog. You can't share your thoughts.
No, like crazy stuff. I mean, when we went... So the first juice bar in California, like I had to submit approval with my compliance department to pursue the opportunity, and then had to get on a call with like our head compliance person in our investment firm to explain, you know, my intentions. And like, are you going to be pitching people to invest in your business or to buy your products? And I'm like, it was crazy. They put me through the ringer. And I remember I wanted to be a YouTuber. Since like 2007, 2006. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And because of the financial institutions that I worked for, I could never do it. This was a dream that was 15 years in the making. I was not allowed to make content and put it online because of my licenses.
So you couldn't share your thoughts.
I couldn't share my thoughts.
You could do it on a one-on-one basis behind closed doors, but you couldn't have that scale that you have now.
Correct. Yeah. The licenses hindered it, and the regulatory bodies made it very hard. So yeah.
How did you get in contact with that Smoothie Juice franchise?
So, and I never got into this point, which was basically, okay, so I thought, all right, I want to put myself in a position to eventually transition out of my job. I've tried to start clothing lines. I've tried to start internet marketing businesses. I've tried MLM. I tried everything. I tried ebook publishing, and I just like wasn't cracking the code. So I thought, you know, this franchise thing seems kind of interesting. And at that point, here's what I knew about me.
They cracked the code before me. Like, I'm just going to jump.
I knew that I was good at following systems and executing. Like, if there's one thing, is that sometimes I follow the system too much. Where someone's like, dude, you got to think for yourself a little bit. And so I just figured if someone gave me a proven system, I could execute the playbook. So I thought, okay, all right, let's take a look at franchising. And then I thought, all right, well, this is probably going to be harder than I think. My wife and I are both busy. She's a successful entrepreneur already. And I'm working full time. So we definitely, I feel like we need to do something that we're passionate and excited about, because it's already going to be hard. And when times get hard, if it's just a business that we have no excitement in, then I'm going to want to quit and give up when things get hard. And so,
and that excitement, did you get that from the industry, or did you get it from having like a B2C type company that you were, you know, industry, interacting with the final customers, your employees?
Yeah, industry. So what, you know, my wife and I were like, we would both like juice and make smoothies at home like every day, pretty much.
Okay.
And, you know, it was a strong core belief. And I teach clients now, it's more than just chasing something you're passionate about when it comes to choosing a franchise or business. Like, you need to have a strong belief in the business, because your passions can change. Like, you could be passionate about something today. A year from now, you're not passionate. And if you just bought a business because you're in a fad of like liking CrossFit or fitness, and then a year from now, you don't like it anymore, well, now you're stuck with the business that you don't really give two craps about. So it's got to be a core belief. And, you know, we just had a belief that, you know, people like eating a healthier lifestyle. Like, if I eat a burger in the middle of the day or tacos, like the carb crash is real. I don't have as much energy. I don't have as much focus. And so we just thought, you know, the juice and smoothie space was an opportunity, something that we believed in. And then, you know, one of the key factors was that I recognized there was tremendous demand in the specific neighborhood we lived in. There weren't any competitors within a 5-mile radius. And so it was kind of a light bulb moment for me.
You knew probably because you were making juices in your kitchen. You're like, probably sometimes you didn't want to make a juice.
Oh yeah. 100%. Yeah, there were a lot of times. And to like clean, it's like, it's a process, man, to clean the juicer afterwards. And like, it's a pain in the butt. So yeah.
So you reached out to this franchisor. Did you talk to current franchisees? How was your evaluation process? If you could walk me through that.
Yeah, man, no one's really asked me these questions. It's funny being on the other side of the table. So here's what I'll say, and it's what I warn my clients against now, which is I had tremendous confirmation bias going through the process, which is when, and I see it all the time. I just talked to someone yesterday where it happened, where people get excited about a concept, and then they don't ask the tough questions. They don't put it through the ringer because they want all roads to lead to, I'm going to do this, as opposed to really tearing it apart to understand the business. And so that happened. And I didn't know how to really do thorough due diligence and like really figure out if this opportunity was right for me. So yeah, we got the FDD. My wife's better at that stuff. And so she tore through the FDD. We did look and compare with about 4 or 5 concepts in that space. So we did say, okay, let's look at, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 different concepts. But then we were a little bit biased because the brand we chose, we had had experience as a customer. And then there were other brands that I didn't even look at that I thought could have been interesting. And we did do franchisee validation, although I didn't know how to really ask those questions. I didn't really know.
Probably the tough questions, right?
The tough ones. Yeah. Yeah. It's just like, you know, again, I'm just like, you know, holding back. Like,
what question or two would you wish you could have asked, like, some of those current franchisees when you were evaluating the brand?
Yeah. Just understanding overall the profit potential of the business. You know, how long does it take to break even in the business? What makes the difference between a location that's profitable and thriving and that doesn't? You know, what regrets do you have about your business? Or if you had to do it all over again, would you? Like, questions like that, right?
Yeah. And I could see when you're in the weeds, and especially as a family decision where your core value is aligned with that business and you know the product, you want to do it. You don't want to have like reasons to like second guess the path you've already gone on.
Yeah. And I see it. I just, you know, I see it all the time. And this is why I'm so adamant about telling people like, don't have confirmation bias. Like I had these clients that came to me 6, 7, 8 months ago and So they reach out, they fill out my coaching application, and they go, hey, like, you know, we're talking about, hey, okay, what's your challenge that you're experiencing? How can I help? Well, we're looking at this pizza franchise. And I'm like, okay, great. And they're like, we're going to do it. And I'm like, okay, then why are you reaching out to me? Like, I'm like, what do you need help with? They're like, well, we want to make sure we're making the right decision. And I'm like, well, have you gone through the FDD yet? No, not really. Have you done like franchisee validation calls yet? No, not really. I'm like, well, how do you know you want to do the business? Like, and I'm like, look, I'm just letting you know that if you hire me to work with me, like, I'm going to help you rip the business apart to validate and make sure it's the right opportunity for you. Like, if you're telling me that you already know you want to go with the franchise and you haven't dug into the FDD in any sort of tangible or detailed way, you haven't done franchisee validation calls, then you're making a huge mistake from day one that you could regret. And this was a franchise that was $700,000-$800,000 to get open. And they wind up hiring me. They wind up not going with that franchise and choosing a different one. So
you probably saved them a lot of time and money.
Yeah. So, you know, just again, looking back, you know, I tell people that you have to distinguish the outcome and the destination from the vehicle.
Okay.
So many people get caught up on the vehicle, AKA the business, right? Ah, I want to open a Chick-fil-A. I want to open a 7-Eleven. I want to open a whatever it is. And then it's like, well, is your outcome to open that business or is your outcome to replace your income? Like, what's the outcome that you're trying to achieve? Well, I make $90,000 a year and I want to replace my income in the next 3 years. Well, like, okay, let's start there. Decide that as your destination, then determine what paths and options will best fit that. Because right now you're just saying you want to own this without like being clear that it's going to get you to your destination. And
it's like, do you still want to own this if it takes 2 years to make substantial income?
Yeah. And what if there's a opportunity that is better suited for your skill set and to get you there quicker? Like, and the analogy I use is someone like they're deciding they're going to go on a 200-mile road trip and they decide to buy a golf cart to do it. Like, golf carts are great, but it's like not the vehicle that you're going to choose for a 200-mile road trip where you're going to be cruising down the highway at 70 miles per hour. You have to choose the right vehicle that gets you there quickly, safely, and comfortably.
So would you say core values first, like what your family's core values are and your individual core values, the destination, and then from there it cascades down?
Yeah, I think you have to really look at what's my vision, right? And categorize that from a financial standpoint, specifically, what do I want? 1 year, 3 year, 5 year. From a lifestyle component, what do I want? This was another mistake that we made in the process. Here's what I didn't really think about in a very concrete way. Okay, juice and smoothie business. How often are they open, do you think?
I would guess 11 to 7 Monday through Sunday.
Yeah. So pretty much we would be open, depending upon the season, from 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. or 7 a.m. to 9 p.m.
Oh, wow. Okay. So, you also had the breakfast crowd.
Yeah. So you're talking about you're open for 14 hours a day, and then we're open, required by the franchise agreement, for about 363 days a year. Right? So if someone's, you know, saying, I want to open a franchise to spend more time with my family, to spend more time with my kids, okay, maybe the franchise affords you that. But in the beginning, maybe you've got to, like,
there's
what happens?
Enough margin. You got to roll up your sleeves.
And what happens when that 19-year-old that you hired in that business calls out for the opening shift?
Yeah,
or the closing
jump in
shift?
And you leave your Christmas Day dinner.
Exactly. And so I've had many days of having those sort of things happen, and it wasn't something I thought about. So, like, you know, that's something that you have to think about. How is this going to impact my lifestyle? There are franchises that are Monday through Friday businesses where you can have a great opportunity to live a flexible lifestyle with your family. But if you're not clear about those things first and define them up front, you could wind up making a huge, huge mistake. And in the beginning, if the business is not doing well, good luck trying to exit that business.
And you see a lot of franchises for sale. I just did a video on, we got to trade notes more on kind of like resources for prospective franchisees, but I went through Biz Buy Sell and there were like 5,000 franchises for sale, anywhere from 5K to like a 9-unit dealership franchise for 60 million. But what I saw under 200,000, it was kind of garbage where the business was for sale for 150K, the owner is making 30K a year, and they're working full time in the business.
Yeah, you know, that's it. That's a really great point, Patrick, because you know, what a lot of people don't talk about is that in the franchise space, a lot of the good opportunities, resales get scooped up and never even hit the public market, right? Because they get bought by another franchisee, their neighboring person. Like, franchisees know each other. They build relationships, and they, before they go to sell it and have to pay 10% of their purchase price to a business broker, like, they just call up their neighbor, say, hey man, like, I'm getting out, you want to buy it?
And it's going to be a much faster transaction. Cause from what I understand, it takes like to sell a business, like through a broker, 6 months. But if you're selling a franchise to a franchisee in an adjacent territory,
quick,
it could be like a 1 to 3 month thing. There's no validation on the brand. They know the brand, they know the numbers, and it's going to move much faster when there's an insider.
Yeah, way, way faster. So the resale space has really become a niche of mine. And I think it's an attractive opportunity. There still are solid opportunities that are profitable. And then there's some turnaround opportunities. And so it's, you know, there's, when you're making a multi-hundred-thousand-dollar decision that requires you to sign a 10-year franchise agreement and a 5 or 10-year lease, you cannot leave it to chance. Like, you just, you can't leave it to chance.
Well, also the downside risk is much bigger than just losing your whole investment. I had a guest on that got sued for 18 years of royalties, hundreds of thousands of dollars of attorney fees that he has to pay out, as well as those 18 years of royalties. And I've gone through some, pretty popular brands, their item, what is it, the item 3, where it discloses the legal actions.
The litigation, yeah.
It's pretty crazy, the litigation, where you have this multimillionaire franchisor that's suing these franchisees into bankruptcy. So you can lose it all, not just the investment you put in, but you have the landlord side where the landlord can get after you, but also the franchisor, whether it's a 10-year agreement, 20-year agreement, you're on the hook for minimum royalties generally.
It's huge. It's a big decision. And, you know, even I had a client yesterday, she's buying a resale and the deal almost fell through because at the very end, right before they're about to close escrow in the deal, the landlord finally just approved her. They were waiting for the lease assignment. The landlord comes back and says, okay, you're approved, but I'm keeping on the previous owners as guarantors.
Which
is common. And yeah, so the owners go, no, then we're not going to sell. So she winds up to appease the landlord and make the deal happen. She winds up putting down a 6-month deposit with the landlord, which I was,
and that's
like,
just money that's sitting there. You're not getting any return on.
Yeah. And it was unfortunate.
With inflation at 8%, that's, you're just killing your cash. That's tough.
Yeah.
But if that's what has to do to get the deal done, I mean, that's it.
Yeah, and it was unfortunate because she did this all without telling me. Like, I was like, oh, I would advise you differently. And, you know, there are ways to structure that, try to negotiate. Okay, if you have to do it that way, okay, for each year in the lease, I get 1 month of the security deposit back towards rent or something like that. There's all sorts of ways, but she was in a unique position where her back was against the wall and she really wanted to buy this, and it was a unique situation. So, but yeah, there's all kinds of crazy stuff. And to this date, our resales, like, my wife and I are still listed as guarantors, so it sucks. It's part of the thing. And it, you know, it's definitely something that can keep me up at night at some point if, you know, if the other owners just decide that they just want to be lazy and run the
bail
business
and move to Mexico.
Yeah.
So you're on the hook.
Yeah. So hopefully they keep running the business as well. But there's a tremendous amount of risk in buying a franchise, and you have to make sure to do your proper due diligence.
And what do you see on the resale side? Like, what resources can people look at just to get their feet wet in terms of like the franchise resale opportunities?
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned Biz Buy Sell. I mean, that's a common one. I mean, there's a whole slew of kind of resale websites that people can kind of peruse and look at, but I don't think it's something that people should navigate by themselves doing a resale, because actually resales can be even more complex. And it's easy if you don't understand P&L statements, profit and loss statements, financial statements. There are ways that people can manipulate those things and make it look like the business is producing at a certain level. Or if you don't understand the numbers to the business, like what the COGS are supposed to be, what certain range, what's the labor cost supposed to be? Or the business owner says that, hey, yeah, no, I'm not working in the business a lot, but their labor cost is like 12%. And it turns out they are in the business a lot. And if you were to actually run it semi-absentee, your labor costs would double, and then the business wouldn't be nearly as profitable. So there's all sorts of websites that people can look at for that. But I tell people to be very, 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 very careful with resales. And that's something that I, you know, work with a lot of my clients to coach them on, because you just have to protect yourself.
Yeah. And I mean, there's so much information that they're going to be getting that needs to be properly vetted, and working with yourself, also with, you know, a corporate attorney and or accountant, the bill's running. So 5K, 10K is pretty common for these type of due diligences, where you might discover, you know, buying a business in Miami, we have the best of Latin America and the worst, sadly, where a lot of cash. People are paying employees in cash, and there's no record of the employee. So, you know, you could take over the business and do an asset purchase, so you're not legally liable and you protect yourself, but are the employees going to stay on, or are you going to have to find all new employees? And if so, at what rate? So there's so many complexities. I find really around 500K, below 500K, the businesses a lot of times aren't being run super professionally.
No.
Where you're dealing with those kind of issues with employment law issues at the end of the day. You know, should it be a W-2? Should it be a 1099 contractor? You know, is the owner, how is the owner being paid? Are they actually drawing a salary from the business? I see it, you know, especially independent businesses, but also franchise resales, when it's under a certain amount, it's like really buyer beware in terms of looking at that business.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, it's, there are just a lot of things to look out for, and it's, you know, it's unfortunate because a lot of people try to wing it and kind of do it by themselves. And sometimes people are just cheap and like, oh, I don't like hire an attorney to look at the FDD, hire an attorney to review your purchase agreement, hire an accountant to look at the numbers and dig through the P&Ls and then the payroll reports. And then like you have to do proper due diligence. And if you don't, you know, buyer beware, and maybe you still luck out, but again, you don't want to leave these things to chance.
And a lot of times people go on site and they'll be there, you know, for 2 weeks or at least a week, where they're tracking the customers coming in, seeing how employees are interacting with the owner. You know, it's a big part of the due diligence as well, like really making sure that there's, if he says there's 100 customers a day and the average ticket's, you know, $12, that there truly are 100 customers a day and people aren't manipulating the systems.
100%. Yeah, what I really appreciate you, Patrick, and you know, now that we've gotten to know each other over the last couple of weeks, is, you know, I think we both share the same skepticism about the franchise industry overall, and then the same desire to really want to help and protect people, you know, because the franchise world, what people don't realize, is a dirty world, and there are a lot of brokers and consultants that do not care about you at all. They just want to sell you a franchise, and whether it works out for you or not, like, they could really, like, maybe they care, but they're just like, it's not my problem after that. And, you know, it's really unfortunate. And so, like, I've really just taken on the stance and why, you know, my content is so detailed. I mean, like, the reality is, like, okay, like, people that reach out to hire me for coaching, like, the reality is you could probably figure, like, it probably most of what I have to say is in my videos. It would just take you a long time to get through all of them.
It's going to take a long time.
Yeah.
It's they not could probably execute it, but it's going to take, like, they're going to have to add in another like 6 months.
Yeah.
Like,
and it's not organized. You know, the videos are made kind of like, you know, at random sequences, but overall I put out very, very detailed content because what I found is, you know, I don't know. I just want to be an advocate for people so that they can make a great decision and, you know, avoid mistakes just through, there was some things that I navigated with our franchises that through sheer mental willpower, I was able to make it work. And I don't feel confident that someone else would have. And I consider myself to be like, when I put my mind to something, like I will not be stopped. Yeah. And what I've realized is that most people are not like that.
No.
And they give up, they quit, they get scared. And so, you know, I get nervous. I get nervous about people making these decisions. And sometimes like, I'm like, man, if they do this.
Well, a lot of the advocates, it's like fly by night, whether it could be like a franchise consultant broker or an outsourced sales organization, or even a salesperson at the franchisor, they're moving around a lot. Like if I look at some of these people's profiles on LinkedIn, it's like they're with a different franchise brand every 18 months, 24 months max. And the person that sold you and got you in the door, they're out. They made their commission. They made their fee from the franchisor. And now you have to live with that decision. So, you know, they're going to be at a different brand. They're not going to be with you day to day. Obviously, there are a lot of major exceptions to that. But largely, you know, the person that gets you super excited with that franchise opportunity, they're not going to be along the ride with you as you open up and as you hopefully get to profitability.
Yeah. Yeah. I totally agree. Yeah. 100%, which is exactly why, like, I named my podcast Zero to Profitable Franchise, and why all of my clients that I work with, they have lifetime access to working with me and my team and in the coaching program, because, and all of the content in the program, there's content about negotiating leases, hiring people, looking at KPIs, because the goal is not to just buy a franchise. The goal is to get the business profitable, make money. And so like, I have a very vested interest. I was just sending emails to, a client today who had launched her franchise back in January, and just like trying to keep track, like, hey, how was April for you? I know you wind up having more estate sales than like you had like your best month in terms of number of sales. Like I want to know, how did it go? Like, yeah. like what's like, I want to be in tune. Like, how can I help you? How can I support you? You know, so there's clients where like, I'm helping them negotiate their leases on the back end and being an advocate for them, where they have a commercial broker, but the commercial broker is just trying to get the deal done. They're trying to get their 3%. Whether you go with this lease or that lease, they really don't care. But if I can help you save an extra 5K, 10K, or have a little bit more leverage, like, to me, I get the pride in that of like, wow, Tariq, thanks so much. Like, we saved an extra 10 grand that we would have never saved, you know, if we didn't work with you. And I just, for me, that's what makes me feel good going to bed at night.
Yeah, it's well said. And, you know, you save them money, but also the potential downside, whether it's with the relationship with the franchisor, with the landlord. And for a lot of these new franchisees, there's a lot you can share with other franchisees as well as the franchisor, but there's other things you don't want to share, where if you're thinking about a sale, how do you start approaching franchisees? How do you approach the franchisor? It's super delicate. And I imagine you can speak to experience, like, the franchisor is not going to be super pumped that you want to get out of their system, no?
Yeah, I think it depends. It depends on, I think, a couple things. Number one, the franchisor, the culture of that brand and what they're like. And then two, your relationship with the franchisor. You know, for me, I had developed a really great rapport and relationship with the franchisor because I was the type of person that went above and beyond with everything. I was always bringing them ideas. I, at my store in California, I created this whole marketing system and way to drive traffic and sales. It was like my proprietary method that I would do. And every time I did it, on the days that I did these campaigns, our sales would go up like 30-40%. And so I gave like the system to the franchisor, and they executed with it and shared it with other franchisees. And I was just known as like people be like surprised. Like a lot of people don't respond to emails, or you send franchisors send a franchisee an email. They get back to them 2 weeks later. Like I was always like, I'd reply right away. I'm being proactive, trying to grow my business. So when I approached the franchisor that, you know, one we were moving from California and wanted to sell, and they were just 100% supportive. Like, hey, we hate to see you leave the system, but you know, we wish your family the best. And I think that's because of two things. One, the franchisor that I was with, they had great values. They were amazing, just an amazing group. And then two, you know, I had a great relationship and rapport with them. Whereas some franchisees who didn't follow the rules, always gave them a hard time, always fought back.
Well, like, you were giving to the system.
Yeah.
You weren't just like taking, extracting everything. Like you contributed a lot to the brand and basically the profits of the franchisor and other franchisees.
Yeah, 100%. But yeah, I think, you know, I think it's just going to depend if someone's trying to leave the system. Like it's kind of like a good boss that helps to groom someone. At some point you groom them enough, you probably know they're going to leave you and go on to a different opportunity. So I think franchisors probably should think of it, you know, that same way, or look at, hey, why are they actually leaving the system? And the reason that they're saying they're leaving the system, is that the true reason why they're actually leaving?
Getting to the root cause at the end of the day, no?
Yeah.
And then I don't know if you've been seeing this, and I don't know if it's the season of the year, all these franchise rankings are released, but I go on LinkedIn and I see everyone boasting about being on some franchise list, whether it's Entrepreneur 500 or some franchise broker top 500 list or a top 100 list. And it seems like it's really negative to the consumer, because like you don't know what's legitimate, what's an actual good list to be on. Like, do your clients ever approach you about like franchise list and like kind of what they mean? How do you deal with like all these lists out there?
You know what? I haven't really, and that's a good question. I remember when I was building out kind of my program and I interviewed 50 people, and they would tell me that they would look through those lists, and it's all BS. They're all vanity. Yeah. They're all vanity metrics. And it's like, it's all BS really. Yeah. And, there's just a lot of, I mean, man, I feel like this interview sounds so negative and like booing on the franchise industry, but it's all with the intention to serve and help and really have people make good decisions. But yeah, most of that stuff is BS. Of course, there's great brands on those lists, but you know, really it comes down to this, is that, you know, what I found, it's what I call my profitable franchise formula. It really comes down to this. If you want to get into a profitable franchise business, it gives you the best opportunity of success. It comes down to, one, you need to make sure there's proper demand in the marketplace. Like, it doesn't matter if the company that your brand you're looking at is number four, number five on that list. If your market is saturated and there are people that have got roots there for the last 10 or 15 years, and it doesn't matter if someone on the other side of the country doing 1.4 million in AUV, like if you may not do well opening up in your market. So there has to be the proper demand. Two, you have to have a strong belief in the business. Do not just buy a franchise because you think you can make a lot of money and you don't care about the product or the service. It's the worst way to go about it. I have so much more to say about that, but two is belief. Number three,
if you're just concerned with making money, there's probably some easier ways that you can go about it.
Yeah. Probably. Yeah. Go rob a bank. No, I'm just kidding. but yeah, there,
you care about is making money. Like there's going to be some ways that you could probably not have to manage people, and you're going to have to go what you went through though, and try 10 or 20 different things until you hit it. But
I agree 100%. And what I find is that people who are just trying to make a lot of money, they tend to be people that have shiny object syndrome that don't really follow through on anything, right? And so it's like, the reality is running a business is hard. Owning a business is hard.
Yeah.
And no matter what, you're going to have to get through the adversity. That's what makes it fun. Newsflash. Yes. Like I work out a lot. I run Spartan races. Every single time I'm running a Spartan race, in the middle of the race, I'm like, why am I doing this? This is terrible. But then when I finish, I'm like, that was amazing. So, you know, the point is, like, there's going to be times that suck. That's the point. Like, that's the beauty of it. You grow, you learn, you become better as a person. And that's the beauty of entrepreneurship. So yeah, if you're just doing it to try to make a lot of money, like that's, it's okay to have that as a goal, but there, you have to
not get you through it though, to hit that destination. If you want to be making 200K, 300K from your franchise, that's definitely possible with a lot of brands, but you know, are you going to be able to get that just being motivated by the money?
Yeah, probably not. So number three is profit potential in the profitable franchise formula, which is most people don't know. And I didn't. Mistake I made. I signed my franchise agreement. Then it's like, okay, you got to fill this out to get the site approved and then fill out this pro forma. And I look at this like massive spreadsheet. I'm like, what is this? This looks like another language to me. And, you know, basically turns out, and one of the pieces of advice I give to my clients are, okay, in order to make a decision on the franchise, like you've got to be able to look at a pro forma. I mean, you got to fill it out yourself. Franchisor is not going to fill it out for you because of income representations, but you need to be able to look at a pro forma to be able to understand the actual potential of the business. And so you got to verify the profit potential. And by the way, all of this, and you know, to make a shameless plug, that I have a masterclass at buyaprofitablefranchise.com where people can, there's a whole hour-long masterclass that's free where I go into incredible depth about all this stuff. So profit potential is one that's super key. There are three ways to analyze the profit potential for a franchise, in my opinion, and probably add a fourth at some point in including Vetted Biz and the data that you have over there. And then number four is that, you know, it really needs to align with your skill sets, right? So, you know, everyone's got unique skill sets that are good to them. And so like, you know, in our franchise, when it came to promoting events or trying to do things in the community, like I got my wife involved. Like my wife is the social butterfly. She fears nothing in terms of rejection, talking to people. What most people don't believe about me is I am an introvert. I actually do not like approaching people. I don't like being in like social settings or networking or those things. So I didn't like doing that stuff. I didn't want to do that stuff. My wife did it. But what I loved was running the business, the operations, the nitty gritty, the looking at the numbers. Yeah. So you got to align with a business that matches all of those things. And it's super key. And then you got to do good due diligence. Like you gotta understand the FDD, how it applies to you. Hire an attorney for the FDD. You have to do due diligence. Like do 3 to 5 quality franchisee validation calls. Like you've got to do these things to vet to then properly make a decision.
Sorry, that's well said. So right now it's a 4-step program.
Yeah, it's basically it's not really a program. That's just like my proprietary, what I call my profitable franchise formula. Yeah, it's just like you just need those four things. If you can validate those four things, then you know you are in a great position to then make the business profitable. Here's the kicker, Patrick. Everything revolves around you. And at the end of the day, you can never blame or really credit the success of the business on the franchise. It comes down to you. You are the one who chose the franchise. You are the one who did the due diligence. You are the one who runs your business. And what a franchise system can't really account for or really show is that franchisees who aren't following the system, who are lazy, who are working 20 hours a week, and who bring down the numbers. And this is why you have to do this ground level reconnaissance and understand, like, some of these top franchisees, maybe they're working 60 hours a week, or maybe they grinded and got involved in the community, or, you know, all these different things. So you really need to understand what, you know, what it takes, and then just really understand that it comes down to you. And if you are a success minded person, winners figure out a way to win.
That's well said. I think we can conclude on that statement. Do you have any final thoughts? We'll leave your contact information in the show notes, as well as a link to that masterclass that you mentioned. Any other concluding thoughts?
Well, everyone got to see just how intense and passionate I really am. I'm an intense person. My clients know that, and I tell them that. I get fired up. I get really excited. But yeah, I think at the end of the day, you know, make good decisions. And check out my YouTube channel. I have just a tremendous amount of videos on how to do due diligence, how to make the decisions, mistakes to avoid, and like all those different things. And go check out that masterclass at buyaprofitablefranchise.com. And it's honestly, I could charge people for that masterclass, but I don't. There's a tremendous amount of value in there.
Well, Tariq, keep that up. I look forward to watching more of your YouTube videos. You obviously are super passionate about the franchising space, and that for the right person with the right business and the right core values mindset, there is that franchise for them. But not many people are willing to roll up their sleeves and really get side by side with the client like you do. And it shows with your work. So definitely keep up the effort.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it. Yeah. And thanks for having me on. It's an honor, and, you know, look forward to, collaborating more. I think, you know, like people in the industry really need to bind together more. And, you know, I think it's synchronistic that we connected, given that, you know, our values and, like you said, our ethos are so aligned. And at the end of the day, look, I could have just crossed over and just been a traditional franchise broker working with people for free, trying to sell as many franchises as I can. And I guarantee you, if I would have gone that route, I could totally just destroy it because of so many people that reach out to me.
Fulfillment wise, you'd probably be 10 years back in your financial advisory position in terms of not being super fulfilled with just selling.
Yeah, for me, I mean, it's really just, it's about doing things that are in alignment with what I believe in. And, you know, I believe in just people making good decisions and protecting themselves. And so if it means buying a franchise, great. If it doesn't mean buying a franchise, then great.
Well, Tariq, I really appreciate your time today. Thanks. Yeah,
awesome. Thanks, man.